Hello from WCPT Congress 2017 in Cape Town. I'm here with Professor Elizabeth Dean. She's professor at the Department of Physical Therapy at the University of British Columbia in Canada. Her symposium just now was concerned with the steps needed to integrate health promotion into practice. To what extent are musculoskeletal conditions associated with lifestyle behavior?
Why did you ask that question? Because so often we've thought about lifestyle, well, that's heart disease, or that's lung disease, and then maybe perhaps diabetes. But now we realize that all those risk factors for those lifestyle-related non-communicable diseases are present in people who come to us to manage their musculoskeletal conditions. We've never thought that way before. We've just thought bad back, bad knee, bad hip, or you've had a stroke, and we've never thought about the bigger picture. But when you look at people with those complaints and you look at their lifestyles, there's a higher proportion of those people. Let me give you a few examples. Look at the relationship of being overweight and obesity with joint problems and joint replacements. There's a very clear relationship. What about nutrition and osteoporosis and demineralization of bone? And we also know that people who smoke or have poor sleep have lower pain thresholds. And of course, pain is the thing that brings people to the physical therapist. So in short, we really have to pay attention and do lifestyle assessments, not only in people who may have heart disease, but check their risk factors and manage those to perhaps eliminate the musculoskeletal problem, or at least reduce it and enable them to respond better to treatment and potentially any drug therapy they may be on too. So a brilliant question, and we're getting very excited because musculoskeletal physical therapy is still the dominant area of practice. So it's not just those people who are managing or people with risk factors for heart disease, stroke, and lung disease.
And how is it possible to implement those behavioral principles into physical therapy practice?
Another brilliant question, because the purpose of our symposium today was to help enlighten physical therapists that these health competencies involve assessment and intervention, just like any other competency. If we were treating a patient with back pain, you kind of do the health and range of strength and range of motion and so on, and then we have specific competencies. In health behavior change, we need to know how to assess health, how to assess lifestyle, and how to intervene. An intervention is really a behavioral medicine issue. It's a psychological issue. How to use existing strategies from the psychology literature in how to, within the context of a physical therapy episode of care, affect health behavior change. So those are competencies, and those are things that we have to learn. And as we said in the Focus Symposium, that we have to teach these. These have to be competencies taught theoretically, practically, and evaluated clinically, just like we would evaluate doing manual therapy at all those three levels.
You introduced a lifestyle behavior change toolkit. Could you explain it in detail, please?
Yes, the toolkit. What we have done over since we started these series of summits, we've done three physical therapy summits on global health. This is really an extension of that. This could be called the fourth one. And what we have looked at is, when we've looked at health behavior change, we said, right, what are the assessment tools? How do you assess smoking? How do you assess nutrition? How do you assess, of course, weight, body mass index, waist circumference, and there are some other things, as well as how do you assess sleep, because we didn't mention that too much here, and stress and physical activity. So those are the things that we need to learn how to assess. And there are established tools for doing that. Now, some are very elaborate, but we have, in our toolkit, we've included those that are best suited to a context of physical therapy care. So we've put this online. It's still building. We've had a bit of a delay this past year. And we've tried to select those valid and reliable tools, because as therapists, we want good tools and that can also serve as outcome measures. So it's not just assessment, but as things change, we want to be able to have a measure that will give us, well, did things change or not? So we are going to use these. And then in the toolkit are strategies and interventions for health behavior change. So we talk about some theory, some theoretical papers, because we have to understand that, but also how do you actually change a person's behavior? And, you know, heart surgery isn't easy, but neither is lifestyle behavior change. So we need to know those competencies. So in our toolkit, what we talked about today, because we had limited time, was a starting point. It was the health improvement card, just to give the participants some confidence about how to assess, to think about intervention, and then a few basic skills. But we really do need to have this adopted by the profession. So we're going to make recommendations to the profession to make sure these are competencies included in our curricula that every therapist and every student does as a basic part of their assessment and intervention. We pay attention to this. This is the day and age of lifestyle-related conditions, and we can't ignore it, for which physical therapists, because we're non-pharmacologic, and all the literature says a healthy lifestyle is many ways superior to drugs and surgery. And how cost-effective is that? So that's what's in our toolkit, and we do have a website that we'll continue to build and will be a resource for educators and for clinicians around the world.
Thank you very much. It was a great pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you so much. My pleasure.
Thank you for your attention. Bye-bye.